everyone. This is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on the episode 8 of BX Academy, Business Excellence, Mentoring and Coaching. Today's episode is on maximizing business valuation for business excellence. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Mara, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonali. Thank you very much and welcome friends and welcome to another edition with Business X. As I'm Gaurav Mara, I'm Chairman of the Franchise India Group and also leads Business X. Business X is a part of Franchise India Group, which works with especially startup and mid-sized companies in terms of how they can scale, how they can look for a new investor, how they can get the right valuation, and also look at exit. We are also a mid-market exit specialist. I do a particularly lot of work in the exit planning space where we guide companies if they're looking to exit the business. So today's topic is really about how do you really build a business valuation? Why it is important and why we are encouraging. Franchise India actually is the first company which started about 7 years back, Business X, with our valuation tool called Biz Equity and started encouraging a lot of small businesses to start going and valuing themselves. It is very, very important because when you go through the whole process of business valuation, you will be able to get a lot of insights about your company. And that would enhance your focus on which areas you need to really do that. So knowing the value of your business is helpful in giving you biggest insights and also insights about your business operation, how efficient they are. You know, sometimes we feel that we have built a great business. When we start doing the valuation and look at a little bit deeper into that, you find that a lot of areas need work. And today's discussion is really about how do you really put a very focused action plan to if you want to look at enhancing your business valuation. Say wherever you are today, and if you look at for 2 years or 3 years, and this can be different reasons. It can be reason capital, it can be looking for an exit, it can be looking for a next partner or any other thing. If you are your idea is to build your value over the time, then this session can be very important for you. So let's start with what are the key insights you need to really get. One, you need to really understand what are the key value drivers in your business. Who is driving the value in the business? Second, also understand all the characteristics of your business. What is your strength areas? What is the core strength area of the business? What is your profitability quotient? How can you increase your cash flows? How you can bring consistency in business? Also, it gives you a very different, a new perspective of why you want to be in this business and what is the next goal for the business to go to next level. Sometimes you've been running the business for a certain way of doing things and the markets would have changed or the consumer has changed or priorities have changed or it looks like it's changing. So if you don't give your business a fresh perspective, a lot of businesses I've seen that get into fatigue. They get into fatigue and they start declining. And this is one of the very important areas. And today, if you really see in this whole world, some businesses get exceptional valuation and some businesses don't get any buyer or any valuation purely because they are not looking from a fresh perspective of what their business stands for and who they want to address and so forth. Now let's get into the purpose of valuation. Why we people want to really get into the purpose of valuation. First is to really define the overall, valuation of the business, which is purchase price. How do you define a purchase price? What is a tangible, intangible assets in your business? Second is financing. Even if you're doing debt or equity, you need to be very sure that what kind of a financing option, how your business is valued and what kind of financing option would suit your business at that stage. Even if you're going for a debt raise or if you're going for an equity raise, both would need an effective valuation to be done. And you need to have a strong professional who can really bring that valuation. Even if you're looking for any kind of a buy-sell agreements within even the existing shareholders, if you want to transfer some shares or acquire somebody's shares, that is also a lot happening, especially in the startup space. A lot of founders come together, later somebody wants to exit, and there has to be a certain amount of internal buy-sell agreements. They all should be valued at a different stages of valuation. Merger and acquisition and sales, obviously that's very important. And when you're looking for any kind of a merger or even in some cases, merger acquisitions happen without any cash being transited, which means that it is purely an equity swap. Those areas also, you need a strong valuation to be done that. And if you are really looking to sell the business completely, 100% ownership or partial ownership, then your business would need also value. A lot of people ask me, even in the state of gifting your business to your family members, you know, so father transferring the business to his son, or you're transferring to your wife or something like that, valuation would be required at that stage also. While there are different norms where you can release from a tax component viewpoint, but you still would need to do your valuation of the business. And finally, if there is a certain amount of dispute in the business between shareholders or stakeholders, that is the time also a certain amount of valuation would need to be brought in. So it's very important. You really have to see any stage you are in the business. And if you're not valued a business, you don't know your business enough. That's very, very important. So please engage a good consultant, a good valuation firm. You can even reach out to BusinessX. BusinessX is a company which has a very big fintech tool called Biz Equity. Go out and check bizequity.com. There we work with, especially small and mid-sized companies who are creating their business valuation. We have separate teams also which go into a deeper understanding of businesses, and then we bring the right valuation up. Now, very importantly, before we go to determine that how we can set our valuation up and what is the future buyer looking at, I mean, especially if you're looking to sell, and even if you're looking for any kind of a partnership or a raise of money or something like that, how do you really prove your valuation case? And this doesn't happen in a day. You need to put yourself at least in a 12-month or a 18-month program. And this 12-month and 18-month program would need maybe a good consultant or a coach along with you to help you improve your business valuation case. But just from a perspective viewpoint, even before we go into understanding what are the 10 things required if you are looking to improve your valuation, let's understand what is people looking at your business and their perspective. Anybody who looks at your business, it might be for an acquisition or partnership or investment, it is looking into the future. It's not looking into the past. And this is one of the mistakes a lot of business owners, entrepreneurs do. Whenever they come to us, they're presenting the past. They're not presenting the future. Half of the pitch decks really are all about talking about that. Smart startups and companies are very clear about talking the future. They are talking the future. They're telling what is now going to be done, what foundation you've laid to really achieve the future. And this is one of the areas which I feel that the legacy business lack. They are doing because there is a lot of past behind it. I mean, they have success stories and things of that nature, but there is no plan for the future, how the business is going to be done. So they're surviving, they're doing well, they have a history, they have a great brand equity, they have a loyal customer base, but there is no definite growth plan which needs to be incoming. So first, define the future, which is very, very important. Second is predictability of the business model. And this is something which is, especially in these times, becoming very, very disturbed. A lot of good businesses, we'd had a term sheet for a big company, a big business, a restaurant company before this COVID happened. And I was very hopeful that term sheet would really come in. But the business has seen in the last 14 months, because it opens up, it goes down, it opens up, it goes down. And the company which was planning to invest into that has actually withdrawn it, because there is no predictability of how it looks like for the next 2 to 3 years, especially in that format, particularly that format. While I think some other businesses would still have the predictability, like a, you know, dark kitchens or a smaller formats or even some other thing, but the business format we were discussing on that lost that predictability. So how do you really define your business model that it has a continuity and certain amount of cash flows and margins continue to improve? That's something which is very, very important. Put your maximum focus on bringing that predictability. Third is unlock value. What is the unlock value you have in your business? And how are you going to see that next 2 to 3 years you're going to unlock that? You know, it can be the brand itself, which can be extended to many other lines, which we do through licensing, sometimes franchising. Sometimes you have a great business and that business can be extensively franchised, because in the category you are in, franchising has been done by your competition and you've not done that. So there is an unlock value which sits in your business. It can be your brand, which can be future extended to multiple products. It can be even strategic location. It can be something which has a very strong unlock value. Keep asking your business and say, what is great about your business which you have not really captured? Something which is sits in your business, but you've not captured. Like we are doing with one of the big pharma brands. I mean, this was a pharma product, which is very generic. Everybody knows that product. Everybody consumed that. Now they're diversifying because they have a lot of SKUs, and very popular company, runs about 170, 180 SKUs. And I'm encouraging them to go into a full-blown pharmacy business. Because they have their good private label really sad. A lot of pharmacies out there are actually struggling to create their private label. They are already sitting on 170 odd products, popular product, market leader, distribution, which is available across India. They are distributing to all the pharmacies all over India. So there is no reason they would not create their own retail interface or direct to consumer business, which is a digital pharmacy or something like that. So obviously they would have to really make the equation between their private label and what they have, but it is very clearly a strategic value. Otherwise they are running as like a commodity, very popular brand, but it's become a commoditized and they are only getting what I call distribution margin or wholesale margin. But if they shift into being integrated operator and start creating their own network and loyal network, it would, the business would change, and it will also give them opportunity to produce next line of products which can come in, because now they have their own funnel of distribution which is loyal to them and they can do that. So sometimes you need to really see what your business is telling you, where is the unlocked value which is there in your business. Leadership is also very important. Who's leading the business, how your leadership is defined, who are the key people, what are their vision about the company, how they are collectively what I call binded by common purpose. That's very important. If you are not binded by common purpose and they are not very linked with the larger goal of the enterprise and structure, that would also not work. I like this culture of in a lot of startups. They are small companies, but they're very clearly binded by goals. Their leadership is very clearly defined. Sometimes the large companies are more confusing because they don't have that defined leadership. They have departments. They have departments which are there, but they don't have what I call a collective leadership mindset. That's why I keep making this comparison that these legacy businesses, old businesses are very finding it extremely difficult to survive in these current environments, while these early startups, companies which come with a fresh culture thinking, different kind of leadership practices, are able to attract a lot of capital and so on and so forth. So how do you really shift that focus? And it's hard. It's hard to do that even in my own company. Even if I try to bring this change, it becomes very difficult because we are also a 24-year-old company. Some of my businesses which I invested early, they have a very different leadership style. Some businesses which have been there old, it just becomes very, very difficult to change because it's a mindset. And mindset runs with every single person in your organization. And that's very, very important to change them. Strategic competitive advantage. What is your competitive advantage and how that would be going to flow? What is your growth plan? What is the growth plan for next 4 or 5 years? What are new products you're bringing in? New markets you want to go? The new channels you want to do that? There is only three ways I understand growth. If you are looking for growing a business, there are only three ways. Define any new products you can bring in. Second, new markets you can go, and new channel you can find to reach your customer. Only 3 days. I don't confuse myself. Whenever I sit with the strategy or any business I coach, I would only talk about these three things. This is my starting point. I say, show me what products we can bring in from your stable. And if you've not done that and your brand stands for those products, I mean, you can still extend yourself to that product. Certainly that's a growth idea. Second, new markets. You're limited to one market. Which other markets we can really go? And third is new channel, which we have not used to reach out to our customer. Another thing which is very important is how do we achieve more with less? Now, this is very clearly, if there were two companies, say, let's put up this restaurant as an example, right? If you have a big restaurant, you are doing certain amount of sales and you have a certain EBITDA performance, bottom line, and somebody who has a lesser resources, much, much smaller restaurant, much lesser people also have the similar kind of profitability margin, I would prefer this business any day. You know, sometimes just deploying more resources to achieve the numbers is not great. Achieving numbers with the lesser resources, lesser deployment of assets, if you're able to sweat out more and get better margins, that businesses to me are more profitable and more valuable in the market. So that's where clearly, so it's essentially how you can achieve more with less. That's the question everybody is asking. Everybody is asking, and that's where technology companies played a very important role. And that's why they were so valuable, because they were achieving more with less. And the conventional companies were not able to do that because they were very much loaded. To achieve the same kind of numbers, they had to deploy much more resources to do that. And finally, what is a purpose-driven path for you? What is a purpose, larger purpose, the next 5 to 10 years? What purpose you define what your enterprise is going to stay for? And purpose is changing. You know, the earlier purposes was purely about shareholder value to be driven. Now it has changed. It has become an order of first understanding, connecting with your customers, then your employees, then your suppliers, then your communities, and finally the investor. It's actually drastically changing how larger companies are now changing their viewpoint on that. It was earlier, it was all about shareholder value or investor value, which was the purpose for enterprise. It was always about to create wealth. It was always about to create incomes. But now, apart from that, it is more about how you are connecting with your customers, how they think about you, how your employees are thinking, how your suppliers are thinking, how your communities are thinking, and finally the investor. Look at the program which is run on now these days on LinkedIn, run by Detol, and they have actually created a beautiful campaign which they are recognizing individuals. So this is a journey which great brands are doing. Great brands are talking and building communities. And these are communities of people who think alike and have they've done initiatives like that. And this program, if you've not gone through, this is a great program which they're running, and everybody is going out and posting on LinkedIn and say, I've been also given this Detol salute for doing my contribution in this whole difficult period. But to me, this is really about building community. This is building about like-minded thinking people and the loyalty Detol would enjoy post this with the brand, with these people who think alike, would be phenomenal. Great job done. I mean, I think as a marketer, I would say it is a phenomenal job. Sometimes easy ideas, simple association, simple reach creates much bigger impact than a large, big propaganda campaigns, which would not be able to do that. So it's a great, if you've not done that, just go out and see this campaign, which is currently going on. A lot of people are doing that. Now let's go on the 10 points, which I will go quickly. This is a 30-minute webinar, so I normally try to finish in about 25 minutes, and then 3-4 minutes if I can wrap it up and we can have some Q&A questions. And if you have any questions, please go out and start asking them in the Q&A box, and Sonali would pick it up, these questions, in later stage. So 10 points in order. First is about how strong, stable your management team is. Essentially, if you're looking for an exit and if you're looking for investment in your business, they would have a different mindset. When we are looking for investment, I'm looking for a founder, his capabilities, his ability to scale, and a lot of these things, I would look at it. If I'm raising capital, I would look at the company, I would say, I will give more marks to the founder and his management team to do that. But when I'm looking for an exit and I'm valuing business, I would like to look at founder, the management team, how the management team is. You see that there is a huge difference in terms of the both approaches. If you are going for a capital raise, then founder, his background, his pedigree, his management team, organizational structure is important, but he is the most important. But when I am looking for exit the business, I don't want to look at founder because he's going to go out of the business. I want to see outside him how the business is not dependent on him. Rather, at that stage, if the business looks too dependent, I will put up a lesser value of the business. So it changes on how you really approach the business. That's very, very important. So how your management team is designed. And if you don't have that management team structured today, start working on that. Get your key roles, get your key things and critical parameters, which are your main value drivers in business, and get your leadership team on that. Second, demonstrate sustainability of your earnings. Now, this is again, sustainability has been used overly everywhere. Even I use it in almost all my webinars, but sometimes it's misunderstood. It's misunderstood because it's just not about the revenue. It's not about the revenue sustainability. You know, sustainability of your competitive advantage, that in next 5 years also, you will be having advantage over your competition. That's more important to me. Second, you will still be relevant over next entire thing. And your sustained growth would come through. So you really have to see a lot of other points of your business to really demonstrate that sustainability. It's just not about the revenue. I've seen companies which have demonstrated 5-6 years of consistent revenues, but they were losing every single day their competitive advantage. They never lost the revenue, so to say, but they were losing their competitive advantage. The brand was slowly not becoming relevant to the target group they stand for. It was shifting very fast. Sometimes you still continue to be there, but you are no more essentially a relevant brand left in the market. So how you're going to be a competitive, having a sustainable competitive advantage over the next few years, that would be very important. Another thing which is very important, how developed your systems and processes are. And this is one of the areas which we work extensively, especially we work with a lot of franchise and retail kind of companies. So how our systems and processes are developed. We have a full team which works on a lot of putting operating structures, training structures, defining every single thing in your business has to be very clearly what I call idiot proof. So which means that it become a function and anybody can do them. So these are very important part of your valuation systems. Financial discipline. Now, this is another big area which comes to, you know, a question mark. So in India, we are talking about producing the maximum number of unicorns in the last year. And these are all investments, if you see, are going to certain kind of companies, right? And why it is not coming to conventional businesses? Why conventional businesses on the other side, we are hearing that all dying out and not able to attract the right kind of capital and so on and so forth. And these companies are getting. So it's not really about the profitability quotient. It's about how well your financial discipline is defined, right? So family-run businesses are sometimes are not very structuredly. I mean, they know their finances, they are disciplined on that, but they are doing it for driving their own family value out of that. So they're not driving the enterprise. So they always would really, you know, so to say, if you put an equation, they would have sales, they would have expenditure, they would have them as a family in between, which is withdrawing a lot of money, and then the profitability, right? So so it's really demanding. And if you look at the new age businesses, they have very clearly professional roles in the business. Everybody, even if you are largest shareholder, you just a professional in the business. You don't have beyond that. Your financial discipline is very right. You very clearly allocated your budgeting. You allocated your resources, allocated your expenses, very clearly defined. So it will be more valuable to me going forward. That's where people like to really invest. A lot of times we have presented some traditional businesses to venture funds, private equity, and they don't like the financial discipline. They don't like the financial discipline. The structure is not so very clear. So they would shy away from these companies. And actually India got that investments. We really saw 3-4 years back, a lot of investments came into family businesses and most of them really burned their hands. I mean, look at Bain Capital investing into a brand called Lilliput. It was a great combination. I mean, the kind of company which you would really like to have sit on your investment side, and how many doors they can open up for you. It's a shame that the company went into a bankruptcy, closed down the entire piece, and they had disputes between them purely because of the financial discipline. I was called by the company, the Bain Capital, and they used to do every Thursday. They started earlier. They used to look at business from a little distance, and they gave the full freedom to the founder. And then they found that there was so much of irregularities in the business. And so they started coming, you know, I still remember somebody who used to sit on the board because it was next to our office, the Lilliput, and he used to come and meet me. And every Thursday he used to fly down from Bombay, come down and see the books. And he used to really tell me that how frustrated he is on what has happened in that business. And they tried their best to really save that because a lot of investment was riding, but eventually nothing was to be saved. And if you see, the brand has shut. It was truly India's first kids wear brand. A great success story initially, great brand, great consumer recall, everything was right. But because of the financial discipline mismanagement or promoter interest too much into the business really collapsed. Minimize your own expenses. As I said, I mean, don't really run your own expenses too much. Create a difference between your executive role and your shareholding. Let your shareholding make dividends as they go along, and keep your own personal expenses a little lower. Then is a transition planning. How you want to transit this business? You know, how do you really want to transit to where it is that today and where it needs to be done? If it is, say, you're seeking funding and building the value, then how you would build a great transition phase that you slowly bring in a great efficient leadership team in the business. And if you were just exiting the business, how you would transit that business and what is the phase of that transition has to be very clearly defined. Another thing which is very important is that how diversified your customer base is. This is a very big question. If you look at a company which has maybe 5 customers giving you great revenue, it looks very interesting because the cost of acquisition is low. You're only talking to 5 companies. And here is a company which is talking to maybe 500 through the same revenue. But to me, truly, this company would be more valuable. While there would be parameters of their cost of acquisition is higher, they have to go and service much larger audience. But if I from a risk viewpoint, I will see it has a lesser risk. While this looks from a from a PL viewpoint, sometimes more attractive because you are dealing with only five, you are servicing them well. And but the valuation wise, I would like to have this company because it has much wider customer base. Even if you have lost 100, you still have lot. And if you really see in this COVID period, companies like these survived. A lot of companies which were based on this. I know a lot of media firms, advertising firms, which have four or five big accounts and they were just about that. And these accounts said, we are not more, no more spending. And suddenly your business collapsed. We've seen businesses going down because they were too dependent on a few of their clients only. They were just supplying to big company and the business was going well. Like say, I was a packaging manufacturer and the only client I have is say an ex FMCG company. That's about it. I don't have any other customer. I'm very happy because they give me the best price. I have a great relationship. I don't have to bother. I just work with them, build relationship. And for reason, they go down. You know, normally if you're working with a big multinational, it doesn't happen. But if they go down, you have no other business which is there. Rather than if you were supplying to a lot of other players, say you're in a food packaging and you're applying to many other companies also, you much diverse consumer base and much more valuable to me as a business model. Then comes in what kind of a brand equity. Everybody talks about brand. I've spent so much money to build the brand and so on and so forth. What is a brand equity? What kind of a market reputation you really enjoy? You need to really see what is to define to understand what is, you know, brand equity itself, right? First is how much it really brings a difference. If this was not branded and this is branded, what difference it is creating in your price? That's a difference to me, what goodwill your brand really brings in. What kind of leadership it enjoys, what kind of consistency it has, what kind of relevance it has to the customer. So all these are very, very important aspects when you're doing your valuation of your brand. Again, diversity of your suppliers also. You cannot be dependent on only few suppliers. If you have a diverse set of suppliers, that also helps you to do that. And finally, the last point which I have is that how your resources are stacked up, how stable they are. You know, your team, your lease, your vendors, your anything, even in your location where you're currently operating, how stable that is going to be. If there is instability or any kind of a risk which comes in there, and I think would reduce your valuation. So those are the points which are early points, while it needs a lot of in-depth understanding in terms of how you really look at your business valuation. So I'd like to invite Sonali. If Sonali, you have any questions for me, I'll be more than happy to take.
Sure. Thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for a wonderful session and a very insightful session as well. We do have quite a few paired up with us, so I'll just take up the ones very quickly. The first question is, can valuation be done very new businesses as young as 6 months old or 1 year old?
Yeah. Valuation can be done at the idea stage also. You know, so it's valuation, obviously, at what stage your business is. Eventually, it would all depend on earnings of the business. I keep repeating that it is all the earnings. But how do you define how your business is going to stack up? What is it going to do in 3 months from now, 3 months, 3 years from now, 5 years from now? It's available. So you will have different stages of valuation. Absolutely. Any given time of enterprise, you would have a valuation of that business.
Right. The next question is, does higher valuation mean better business in a gist?
Absolutely. 100%, if it is directly proportionate to what you have. I mean, end of the day, it's about the valuation is to compare with your, what I call capital. Capital is your debt and equity. What equity you have, whatever you are able to put more to your equity base, that's your valuation, right? So fundamental, this is your base equity and this is where, if you have a business which has certain amount of debt, say you have 50 lakh rupees of debt, and the balance is your equity sitting there. So equity is your base equity, and whatever valuation, the performance of business would sit on this, and this becomes your total value of the business.
Right. The next question is business valuation mandatory if you're looking to raise capital from investors for a startup?
100%. Business valuation is mandatory. I would say it should be mandatory for all businesses, not necessarily even they are looking for any kind of capital raise or doing that. I call business valuation as an exercise to really know your business well. You know, sometimes you're doing your own business, and I know how hard Indian entrepreneurs work. They work the hardest. They work 7 days, all the entire thing, and they're not even making return on their own time. They're not making return on their own time. Forget about the valuation of the business. A lot of people I know as traditional retailers, you know, so they used to go to their businesses. They have stocks lying of 10 crores and making businesses which had no meaning to me. It's not even justifying sweating out the capital. I used to joke with a lot of retailers, especially these jewelers and other places. I say, take that money out, put into any other passive asset class and sit at home or sit at the beach at Goa. You'll make more money than what you're doing now. And you all day worried what needs to be done. So people don't have really understand what they're trying to do because they're traditionally going on and they have the comfort of certain incomes coming to them. It doesn't justify it. So sometimes when you start doing valuation, you start doing, why am I doing this? What is going to be the future of this entire thing? That's very, very important.
Absolutely, sir. The next question is, how often should we get our business valued? Is 3 years a good window time? So there can be some changes made in the business as well during the time.
Good question. I think if business has not significantly changed in any parameters, then you can put maybe 2 years to do a business valuation. But if it is changed in significantly, like it happens with early stage companies, they move very, very fast. Every 3 months, they have different goal sheet which has come in. So they need to continue to do it 6 months or 1 year. It's not really getting a fresh valuation. It's just about tweaking your numbers, how you see the numbers now, how your margins have improved, so everything would really cost of sales have come down. So everything is a parameter. So when you start doing valuation, you get these all fundamental parameters. And then you need to really see how can I do incremental change in these parameters.
Right. The next question is, does changing the business model also affect the business valuation of a company?
Yeah, significantly, as I said, achieving more with less. So ask yourself if you can go to your business tomorrow and say, I want to do the same thing, but I don't want to have the same infrastructure being there. Even if you had 1 week of thought process, and everybody can do it, especially today's time, with technology, with everything else, if you can go out and say, I can achieve this with much lesser resources available, you'll suddenly make your business much more valuable, much more valuable. So we don't ask this question. This is a very important question you need to ask. Sometimes common sense is more important. We keep hearing these webinars and listening to a entire thing, but we leave the common sense. Common sense is very clearly, if you can achieve the same purpose of business is to create, some kind of a profitability. If I can achieve that same profitability with doing less, you know, it can be less time being deployed, lesser resources, lesser, equipment, anything. Sometimes say you're producing something which you're working hard and you have factory which is struggling and all that entire thing, and you go out and outsource this entire thing to somebody who has much larger capability available, much efficient structure to do that. I remember when I started my career, I used to have, we started as a magazine. And my magazine used to be printed in the local machines in a local company in printing press in Chandigarh. And they used to take 7 days to produce only 2,000 copies, right? 7 days. And 7 days, my younger brother used to go there and sit there and see the print and it's coming right, it's binded right. Then we used to ship it to Delhi and then circulation used to happen. And then we started growing and then we had 4,000 copies required, 5,000, we started 10 days. Then he started saying, give me even an advance. Then we used to have fights with him because his factory was only doing our work. He cannot take other work. So he's spoiling his customers. So he used to break our time in the night. He'll start taking other jobs. So then we decided, we got tired and said, let's shift to somebody else. There must be somebody else which can do a better job. And we went to Thomson Press, which is the biggest press in India. This is early 2000. And they used to do the same work, actually 45,000 copies in 3 hours. So if you really see, the same thing has changed. I'm doing 45,000 copies, 3 hours. My team goes in the night, puts the entire thing. We don't even go to the factory. They directly ship the files there. And the printed stuff comes in the morning at 7 o'clock to us. And we have that entire thing. So what has happened? I've really changed the resources deployed for that whole piece, right? And that has become more efficient. So I have now 7 days more to sell advertisement more. Really, it's not about seven to, if I have to say 7 days more to do the same job, because I have to close my magazine. Now I have 7 days more. I just have 3 hours to print this entire thing. So even I can, 3 hours before also, I can take the advertisement to come because I can send it to printing. So a lot of things change when you start looking at different perspective. A lot of people run these micro factories, micro operations, micro structure. They feel that they're in control, but actually no. Stop your factory, close that business, outsource that piece to somebody else. Focus on your customer. Focus on your customer, you'll become more efficient and more empathy. Who's asked every time you buy any product from Unilever and that, have you asked, is it been produced by Unilever? Answer is no. You're just buying the product. Somebody else is producing. So you, this is very, very important. Next.
Absolutely. The next question we have is, how does the value of a company change with the number of founders, and is the first investor important?
But initial days, who's bringing what is important. Who you're changing with also is important. So if there was first founder was very critical to that business and you change it with something who's not as competent as that, then obviously it will change. But if you change it with somebody who's even more competent, then why should it change? Again, it's very, very common sense thinking. People are investing on initial days when the business has no transmitter, right? Who are you investing on? You're investing on founders, their journey, their mission, their goal, their background, and so on and so forth. Because there is no other thing to read. When somebody comes to your boardroom and presents you, you have nothing else to read. Like I built a business which is called a Bodybuilding India. It was the first supplement company, and I was the first lead investor in that business. I was doing a seminar, and somebody came to me, a doctor, and said, look, I have an idea. I want to start a supplement store. And at that time, what would I see? He was a doctor. He was a practicing doctor. He believed in that. He was himself very focused on supplements. He'd done a lot of research. He has another partner who's also a surgeon. And his father used to run this business. So I saw that very clearly these two gentlemen are very committed. They are professionals. They're doctors. They understand the subject well. They are also very serious about telling authentic stuff. And some one of them has a background on this piece. So I invested into business, created a model and everything. I took that business to about 75 stores and I exited 90 on that business. And that time they had about 65 odd stores, a good online presence and so on and so forth. And the business was nothing. Actually, they opened up a bank account after that when we started investing in the business. And it went to, the last I know, was running at a 30 crore with the decent 10%, 12% EBITDA. And this journey is only 4 to 5 years. So really speaking, this is how, and I actually went out and sold to one of the promoters, one of the doctors itself, my stake. And I encouraged him that to buy out now, you need to have certain positioning so that you can bring in the future investors so that you have enough available equity, free equity. Sometimes this is another mistake a lot of founders do. They choke up their equity. They don't have free equity. If they don't have free equity, what are they going to offer to everybody else?
Right. The next question that I'd like to quickly take up is, can a solopreneur also go for valuation for his company?
Yeah. Why not? You can go for a valuation for your company. If you have a strong idea, you can go for that valuation for business. Different stages of value. If the running business is obviously you're not. Future is on your future, how it is going to be. But be very realistic on valuation. Don't chase a number in your mind. Let your business design what it deserves. Sometimes entrepreneurs chase a number in their mind, right? I think I should be 250 crore value because I heard that similar company was something like that. It doesn't make any sense to me because sometimes you're not reading your own numbers, right? It's not telling you the real facts.
Absolutely. And lastly, an attendee has asked to provide the name of the marketing campaign that was running on LinkedIn that you mentioned earlier in the webinar.
Actually, Dettol, which we use, hand wash. So they have legally launched a campaign for people who have been active on this and did some service on this COVID period and things like that. So actually, like say Sonali would have done an effort. So the Dettol would send her a bottle with her picture on that rather than having any celebrity. So, and that can be available on the shelf also. So it's a very simple idea, very, very simple idea, but it's community building. It's building community. So it's a changing of the way organizations think. They are changing the way they look at their customers, they look at the employees, they look at suppliers and their communities. And the last, they're looking at investors. So it's very different. It's a very good campaign. I really acknowledge that this is a perfect timing. It's a good way to really build community base, a very strong positioning for Dettol. And it's also demonstrate leadership. They're fresh in thinking, their leadership. So it's a good campaign, which I saw. I mean, I yesterday saw some of my actually employees and ex-employees been putting that. So it came on that. So I just then started researching. A lot of them people I saw are doing that. So it is a good way of running that campaign.
Absolutely. With this, sir, I'll just wrap up the Q&A session. And thank you so much for answering all our questions very patiently, like always. We have actually exceeded the time limit for the webinar. But thank you so much once again, Gaurav, sir. Anything you would like to say in the end?
Thank you very much. And thanks for coming on these webinars. Franchise India will continue to engage our community, which is about small businesses, mid-sized businesses. That's what we are known for. And that's what we always would be known for. We're very focused on that part of the audience. And I feel that 97% of India is about small and medium enterprises. And so think fresh in your business. Don't really, whatever has been done is done. Just take a break, put yourself in one day and say, can I do this in a different perspective? Can I do this with much lesser resources? And you see that your business would change and the way you think and look at businesses would change. And I have done it in one of my companies. I was running in that particular company, 84 people team. And the business was, while top line was great and everything is okay, but no margins, no profitability and so forth. So I'm trying to look at how can I do the same business with 20 people and bring that make it profitability. And when you are profitable, you can look after better things. You can look after your more better value for your customers, your better engagement, your better for your employees. Everything is then much better, right? So stretch businesses actually stretch everything around them, right? So you have to really look at a fresh perspective to your businesses. And if you are interested to get any support on valuation, any support to help you scale the business, any advice you need to even exit your business, please reach out to us at BusinessX to Sonali, and we'll be more than happy to assist you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Gaurav, sir. And thank you to all our attendees. We really hope we were able to add some value to your lives through this session. And as Gaurav sir said, if you have any questions, any concerns, please reach out to me. Or if you have any feedback or you need the recording of this session, I'll be more than happy to help you. And we'll see you next Saturday at 11 a.m. with another session in this series, BX Academy. Thank you so much.